Random House Audio presents Different, Escaping the Competitive Herd, Standing Out in a World Where Conformity Reigns But Exceptions Rule, by Youngme Moon. This is Bernadette Dunne. Introduction. When my eldest son was in second grade, he started bringing home poems to memorize. Each week, a new poem. So each night, we would memorize a verse, repeating the words over and over again until they were securely mimeographed into the folds of his supple little brain. At first, I did this without question or complaint. But as the days passed, I found myself reconsidering the purpose of these mental calisthenics. You see, for the past 10 years, I have been an educator myself, a professor of marketing at the Harvard Business School, where every semester, my colleagues and I require our students to master a very particular language. We expose them to the grammar of business, essentially a set of frameworks and best practices, and we make them rehearse this grammar over and over again in case study after case study. But what I have learned from this experience is that while a commitment to rehearsal will almost always produce competence, it will almost always produce a kind of automaticity, too. There is a reason why so many educators rail against rote learning, and it is that they know it can have the self-defeating effect of promoting a kind of mindlessness. Once we overlearn something, we cease to know it anymore at all. This is what I see happening in the world of business today. In industry after industry, business professionals have become so practiced in a particular way of doing things that they appear to have forgotten the point of it all, which is to create meaningful and compelling product offerings for people like you and me. This is not to say that these folks lack the requisite business skills. Rather, it is to say that they have become almost too proficient, in the same way that a well-oiled production system can be scarily proficient at churning out one perfectly identical clone after another. I may be a business academic, but I am also a citizen, a wife, and a mother, and my guess is that I probably experience the world in much the same way that you experience it. Which means that when I leave my house to purchase something as prosaic as a bottle of shampoo or a carton of juice or a pair of sneakers, what happens to me is probably very similar to what happens to you. I am confronted with a dizzying array of options from which to choose. In every aisle, in every store, what used to be just a generation ago a relatively modest selection of, say, 4 or 5, has somehow turned into an indistinguishable selection of 110,000. Meanwhile, there is a redundancy in the way these products are advertised to me as well. To be fluent in the language of product marketing is apparently to have polished the language of hyperbole, and so I am assured again and again that each one of these products is new and improved. Everything is big, better, best. And yet here is the thing. We've all lived through quite a lot in the past few years. This most recent recession in particular hit us all pretty hard, and although each one of us had little choice but to weather through in our own private way, I can't help but believe that the storm refocused us all in some collective way too. I remember right after the first wave of the recession hit, the housing market had just imploded and the credit markets had frozen up, feeling almost grateful that I didn't live in one of the more sumptuous estates in our town, one of those homes that I used to so admire. I also remember reading stories in the newspaper about how people, even those who were financially secure, had begun rethinking their most basic consumption patterns. It was as if our notions of aspiration and acquisition had shifted overnight. Excess was out, replaced by a more thoughtful consideration of the stuff with which we filled our homes, our closets, our lives. The age of abundance is over, I remember thinking. Not because things are no longer abundant, but because abundance has lost its status as our reigning aspiration. I have always believed that there is a part of business that is an art. And if I had to describe the particular complexion of this art, I would describe it as the art of calibration. In my mind, this is where the marketer must step in. The marketer needs to be able to ascertain the dimensions of our desire, paying heed to the things that we want, yes, but paying equal heed to the things that we do not. It may be true that our desire has no limit, but it certainly has a shape. Yet what is missing from business today is a sensitivity to the contours of our aspiration. As a culture, we have moved well past the point where we are impressed by the traditional markers of affluence, the profusion of look-alike choices, the embarrassing display of whistles and bells. Nevertheless, to this day, one need only to walk into a store to experience the degree to which business doesn't seem to get this. A decade ago, product marketing could afford to be as over-the-top as rock and roll. Hyperbole came with the territory. A lack of originality was no big deal. To get the crowd's attention, all you needed was to memorize a couple of predictable chord progressions, nail a catchy chorus, and then hit the stage with confidence, energy, and enthusiasm. The trick was to be loud, excessive, bold. A few smoke and mirrors didn't hurt either. Today, that kind of marketing is likely to appear as vacuous as a 1980s heavy metal band. Today, the business maestros more likely to garner a listening audience are the ones who understand that in this era of more thoughtful consumption, louder is seldom better, and more of the same almost never adds up to the best. I wrote this book because I believe that what most of us are looking for today is a sound more resonant, a sound more meaningful, a vibration that we are able to experience in our bones as being somehow different. And so that is what this book is about. It is an exploration of what it means for a business to commit to giving us this. It is an exploration of what it means for a business to decide to be different. I do this by venturing into the world of sameness in search of difference. I seek to identify the outliers, the anomalies, the iconoclasts, the players who have rejected well-rehearsed business routines in favor of an approach more adventurous. These are the players with a feel for improvisation, for experimentation, the players who have somehow managed to build brands and create products that are striking a genuine chord with even the most jaded among us. Along the way, I make the argument that it is time for business professionals, marketers in particular, to begin letting go of some of the things that they have come to regard as best practice. This is no easy challenge. As I tell my students, learning is easy, forgetting is hard. Yet this is precisely what I believe is necessary if business is to build a new culture of consumer engagement, one that creates at the very least the possibility that we will begin listening again. Incidentally, this past year was my younger son's turn to start second grade. As expected, it wasn't long before he, like his brother before him, began bringing home poems to memorize. Each week, a new poem, and so each night I found myself dutifully feeding him his lines over and over again, my déjà vu complete. Only this time, my heart wasn't in it, because over the years I have come to believe that a poem perfectly memorized is a poem too easily recited, and a poem performed without effort is a poem that has lost all meaning. I have a friend, a businesswoman, who claims that she can absorb the gist of a business book, any business book, in under an hour. Of course, whether or not you're impressed by her claim depends on whether you've ever read one yourself. Most business books are written for easy digestion. They are reductive in the way that subway maps are reductive. The elimination of unnecessary information creates a kind of conceptual isolation that is functionally efficient to the extreme. But reduction can come at a cost. A few years ago, Edward Tufte, who resides at Yale and spends most of his time thinking about the presentation of information, published a monograph, The Cognitive Style of PowerPoint, about the cognitive hegemony of the world's most popular presentation software. As Tufte pointed out, the unfortunate price of simplification is, well, oversimplification. Not to mention the additional tax paid out in the form of pedantry. Imagine if you were to go to a dinner party, only to discover that all of the guests had decided to present their stories in PowerPoint format. Yes, the evening would be informative, but it would also be a bore. When I was in college, I remember reading a book by the Nobel Prize-winning physicist Richard Feynman, entitled Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman. What was interesting about the book was that it appeared to be nothing more than a compilation of rambling anecdotes about his personal life, his teaching, his work. And yet the weight of these anecdotes crept up on you, so that by the time you finished the book, it was impossible to regard it as anything less.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.